Hey there, scary story fanatics. Welcome back to Cleaving Thought from Bone with your host, Sociopathic. Ever wonder what it's all about? Why there are monsters lurking in underground complexes at abandoned themed parks? Or maybe what's really going on with all these Disney-related disappearances? Well, just shy of me spelling it out, those questions may be answered, though you may wish they never had been. So, lock your doors and swear to never leave your house for a vacation again, quarantine or not. I call tonight's juicy tale of amusement, the unhappiest place on earth.
Those hollow eyes, those vacant expressions, and there's nothing natural about something that smiles all the time. I never did like the mascots very much, but ever since I was a little boy, I've always loved Disney World. My dad made pretty good money, but my mother had a taste for the finer things in life, and this meant that we still lived on a budget. Somewhat expanded to accommodate for a few luxuries, like the hot tub and the in-ground heated swimming pool. But my father still had to work himself nearly dead in order to pay for it all. I guess I never appreciated it as a child, but now that I'm older and realize exactly how much a trip to Disney costs, I have come to the full realization of my father's accomplishment in being able to take me nearly each and every summer. I remember growing up knowing that most of the kids I went to school with had never been, and when I was younger, I couldn't understand why. A parent's efforts are only truly realized after the fact, I suppose. I guess it helped that my parents loved everything Disney, especially my mother. Some people collect porcelain cats or little duck-printed trinkets, but my mother, Disney. Little Mermaid cups, which my father wasn't too fond of, Bambi throw blankets on the couch, not to mention the Mickey Mouse brands on just about everything that can be thought of. Even my dad's den had a few things in it, up to and including a glass case full of some super rare Disney memorabilia. When we moved to Florida, my junior year in high school, and graduating not even 2 years afterward, a job at Walt Disney World seemed like a no-brainer. Okay, so going to Walt Disney World, super fun. Working there, not so much. Talk about one of the biggest letdowns ever. Sure, the first couple of days were pretty cool, and I kept telling myself that things would get better, get easier. But they never did, and my childhood dreams shattered into a million pieces, kind of sending me into a depression for a bit. Okay, so I was still basically a teenager, and kind of making a mountain out of a molehill. Sure, things were bad, but not bad enough to do what I did. But let me be very clear about the conditions I'm referring to here, lest they may spark a bit of sympathy for my stupidity. In case you haven't heard, it's hot in Florida. And not just hot. Humid. Okay, so if you haven't been on the fucking moon your entire life, you probably already knew that. Well, the corporate mouse has no sympathy for its employees' heat issues. Breaks are limited, the hours are as long as they are mandatory, and the pay is minimum wage. And for anyone who's been keeping track, minimum wage for Florida is exactly that, the bare minimum. Why would anyone take such a shitty job, you ask? Well, in order to understand that, I suppose you have to understand the different walks of life people come from to find their way here. There's people like me, of course, who have grown up with the inherent love for anything and everything Disney, and working at one of their world-renowned parks is nothing short of a childhood dream fulfilled. Then, there's the college interns that come for the experience and stay for the free admission. And lastly, you have the ones who have applied out of convenience or necessity, and start off with no attachment to the establishment. But somewhere along the line, become so committed to this insane asylum of a conglomerate that few ever leave. Another thing you have to understand is the red carpet Disney puts out for its new hires, romanticizing them with the delusions of supplying happiness and childhood dreams to the hearts of wanting children. And they do this so well that you actually end up believing that it's all worth the 12 to 14 hour days at $7.25 an hour, or whatever the hell it is now. In fact, their brainwashing methods are so good, a worker will begin to feel obligated at the responsibility, nearly to the point of working themselves to death. In fact, some actually do. Case in point, in 2006, someone was working at the Splash Mountain Resort and collapsed and had to be hospitalized. Now officially, that's where the story ends. Rumors have continued to make their way around the staff, like cultural ghost stories. But that's all that remains of them. The story I've been told is that the guy died from heat stroke and dehydration. Think about that. The dude is working at Splash Mountain and is refused a break and or a drink or even a cool down in the water to the point to which he collapses and dies from the heat. But that's exactly what working here is like. And it's also the reason I'm inclined to believe this story. But like I said, on record, that's all it is. A story. Let's just say that they hooked me, line and sinker. I was all in, shitty ass job or not. Now, as I had grown up, the fear those mascot faces used to instill in me had faded, especially now, as I merely looked upon each one as co-workers. I couldn't have told you the names of everyone that donned a mascot costume, as each does claim that they're the only Mickey or Donald or whatever in the park. That's a flat-out lie. At any given time, there could be 7 or 8 whatevers simultaneously, restricted to their own certain quadrants of the park. I'd wave occasionally and get a wave back, but even though I took break with some of these people, they would never break character. Never speak. There's a certain level of commitment that comes with that job. There's even a special training program. How else could they convince these people that sweltering to death in what is essentially a multi-layered heat blanket is a rewarding and meaningful job that no one could ever leave or disgrace? Even talking with these individuals after work, they are still so steadfast to the company line that they would literally not tell me who they played. This is, in fact, Disney policy. The people who play mascots are never allowed to say who they played, only that they, quote-unquote, hung out with them. So, if someone dons a Donald costume for a shift, they can tell you that they hung out with Donald Duck, can't say that they were him. So, how many people in total are there playing mascots at Disney World? Well, between the interchanging of characters between employees and the demanded anonymity, it is honestly impossible for any one person, at least in my position, to accurately discern such a fact. There is a literal mystery that envelops not only Disney World, but the mascot subculture specifically is truly enigmatic. Why, oh why, would I be so stupid? Did you know that Disney World hosts a parade every single day? And like I said, I don't know everyone who plays the mascots, but I know quite a few, some of them my friends, and at least one of them trusting and accommodating enough to let me borrow their outfit. Are you getting the picture yet? I wanted to know more, see where these guys go and rally themselves, to witness firsthand this infamous mascot trading regiment. Sneaking into and mingling with a parade full of like-attired individuals who have taken an oath of silence, hidden by masks, didn't seem all too complicated. The only downfall I could see at the beginning was having to wear the same underwear assigned to the costume, and I wasn't truly assigned to it. I decided I would retain my own. Let me clarify here. Mascotted individuals are required to wear only Disney-approved underwear. Meaning literally, different people wearing the same costume are forced to wear the same underpants that come with it. Washed or not, that's just fucking gross. Pulling the bodysuit up to my shoulders and getting zipped in, I instantly realized how hot these things get. I lifted the bucktooth Goofy helmet and lowered it onto my head, essentially locking the heat inside with me, limited to the sight awarded by the tunnel vision through two moderately sized pupil holes. I quickly found myself hoping that I wouldn't have to wear this atrocity for too long. I honestly didn't know how long I would make it before I would either pass out unconscious or be forced to remove the overbearing fursuit from my soon-to-be-drenched-with-sweat form. I made my way up to the streets and joined in where my friend was supposed to. Things went essentially according to plan. There wasn't any choreography or anything like that to rehearse and remember. I basically waved my hand and stopped occasionally to take a picture with a child or two and their vicariously living parents. I know the thing really doesn't last that long, having watched so many times firsthand, but it felt like a lifetime had passed before we concluded our walks in the blazing summer sun and headed towards a wooden door in a tree, marked in playful lettering, "Restricted Access." The leader in front opened it with an electronic key, and into the blackness beyond, we marched single file. Now, I'm pretty sure this is where things took a disastrous turn, because, for reasons unknown to me, the parade line began to file off into two separate directions, with some of the personnel going one way and some another. One line of employees was only comprised of mascots, and the other of mascots and various parade performers. My turn to pick a direction was coming up fast, and a decision made in haste was all I could manage. So, I altered my trajectory to go left, following the crowd of mascots only. There was a Mickey Mouse, a Minnie Mouse, a Donald Duck, and a Pluto. I was the only Goofy, thank God, for I feared they would have found me out otherwise. But in actuality, the four of them paid little attention to me, only wandering further and further down a dimly lit corridor with a single hanging light at the end. Now, I had been down the utilidors before. They're monolithic in their design, and so complex, almost impossible to navigate without a proper map. Granted, I hadn't nearly seen all of them in their entirety, just because the underground complex spans so far. But everything I had seen down there up until this point was colorful and animated, in line with the styles of the rest of the park, which was a little ironic, as no parkgoer would ever see them. But the hall I walked now was contrastingly much darker and more barren than all the others. If this place had a mood, whatever section of the Utilidors this would be, that mood would be hateful and longing. The atmosphere in here was nearly as oppressive as this damn suit. There were no people down here, and everyone I knew took off their damn suits as soon as they were away from prying eyes of the public. Why weren't these people taking off their outfits? I kept wondering to myself. I couldn't place my finger as to what it was, but something told me I should do the same, and I decided to leave mine on as well, doing my best not to stand out. Though my attempts at this would soon prove futile, and I continued walking unknowingly behind a group of what are now maniacs and delusionary lunatics. When we reached the light source at the end, I noted it to be highlighting the metal door over which it swung slightly back and forth. The door was completely blank, not even a handle, but a few moments after we had halted at its perimeter, a loud buzzer noise echoed intensely down the hall, followed by a loud pop noise, and the large metal door creaking open an inch or two. Mickey Mouse, the guy up front, reached out with his fuzzy digits extended and grabbed the door at its edge before pulling it open widely. The door ached at its hinges loudly, stopping only when Mickey had let go and stepped through the resulting aperture. The three behind him followed, and so did I. I found myself wondering why I had decided to follow this group instead of the other. That was simple. This was a group of only mascots. Surely this would provide the best chance at a look at such a concealed lifestyle of working at Disney. But after I had stepped through behind them, the last one through the door, the thing slammed shut behind me, locking me in. I found myself wishing I had chosen the latter. Darkness and fear crept over me, like the probing legs of 1,000 insects, and climbed its way into the deepest reaches of my soul, shaking me at the quick of everything that I was. There were some very distant lights, that much of what I could see, were nothing more than black silhouettes of shapes and patterns all twisted together to form massive occlusions to my already impaired vision of what now looked to be an ever-stretching hallway. Another Utilidor, but this one more sinister feeling than anything witnessed yet. Once the smell had reached my nostrils, the stench of animals in uncleaned pens and the sounds of far-off misery seeped through my goofy-headed gear and into my ear canals, that I reached my hand backwards for the door, hoping to abscond back whence I came. But there was no handle, no knob, nothing that would allow me to free the latch and open the damn thing. This was a terribly bad idea. I had had my suspicions previous to entering this wicked place, but now my apprehensions were concretely solidified into my hindsight insight. I could barely make them out, the four beings wearing those iconic suits, as they were nothing but dark silhouettes that parted ways at infrequent intervals to go either left or right, before stopping for a moment and disappearing into the black wall before me. The subsequent bang of metal on metal that occurred only moments after, letting me know that they had each entered a door, in a structure that wasn't all that dissimilarly laid out from a prison. I wasn't sure what to do next, so I just stood there, wanting to flee, but unable. pondering moving forward, but nearly unwilling. Shakily, I placed one foot in front of the other and began to walk the length of that long and dimly lit corridor. It was only after 3 or 4 steps that overhead lights began to turn on, one by one, down the length of the hallway before me, causing me to instinctively run back towards that plain metal door. My efforts to get through would be in vain, and I knew that, but my brain wasn't exactly thinking logically at the moment. Once I had reached it, however, only a few short steps away, I instantly realized my mistake. But now, completely frozen at the thought of traversing that now lit corridor, adorned with untold numbers of grimy gray and brown doors and puddles of filthy water, or some other more insidious fluid, my mind refused, and I remained where I now stood. Back to that solid gray panel that once revealed itself to be a doorway. Moments passed, but each ticked by as a lifetime, and I expected something, anything, to happen at any moment. But nothing did. Not right away. The silence and lack of action, my thoughts once again returned to me. My heart was racing, and the adrenaline strong in my cardiovascular system, but the capability of deductive reasoning returned to me. Now, I don't remove the grates from vents often, but I've seen enough of them that I know that most are way too small to fit inside. Ones that aren't are usually impaled hundreds of times with long screws, essentially making an extra long Iron Maiden. But when I pried the cover from the one beside me, I realized it to be the latter type. The space was long, carnivorous, dark as crude oil, and sported hundreds, maybe thousands of long sheet metal screws, all torqued in from the outside. The way I saw it, I didn't have a choice. I had to remove the goofy costume to get inside, and although this left me feeling naked and vulnerable, being stripped down to my sweat-drenched boxer shorts, I was glad to be rid of the damn thing. Scraping and cutting, stabbing myself more than 50 times if not once, all at once, as I slid myself inside the torturous vent in a way that I could refit the face. I began to inch my way backward as quickly as I could while avoiding further injury to myself, both of which I seemed to be failing at, as with every movement of my body, I seemed to endure a new wound, and I wasn't making much progress. Luckily, or so I figured at the time, nearly consumed by the blackness that enveloped it, was a dim light emanating from my left. There was a passage to my left, not too far from where I lay, and wherever it led, it was far brighter than this place. A distant sound, emanating from back the way I came, echoed around me. A door, somewhere back that way, had either just opened or closed. I soon realized it to be the former, as loud and heavy steps clacked louder and closer off the cement substrate. Someone was slowly and methodically headed in my direction, towards the vent I had foolishly crawled into. I saw large, almost military-style boots stop just short of the pile that was the goofy outfit I left laying in a heap on the floor. The offshoot was right there, and I distinctly remember recalling the phrase, "so close, but so far," as I desperately tried to not make a sound. That's when I felt something horribly wrong. Something that didn't hurt instantly, but would certainly A, do so in due time, and B, cause a major issue. Doing my best to make haste, I carelessly went to shift my weight onto my right palm, and as I moved my hand, I shifted myself to do so. A long sheet metal screw impaled my hand almost right through the center. A nail was one thing, but the threads on these screws are gouged and deep. Simply sliding it off my hand wasn't an option. Under normal circumstances, you would unscrew the thing counterclockwise from the flesh. Well, that certainly wasn't an option. The next choice would be to obviously yank it free as fast and as forceful as possible. This, of course, would be extremely excruciating, but I was left with only the third option, as the second would make a lot of noise and give away my position to the mask-wearing figure now examining the goofy costume on the other side of the vent grate. I did have to simply pull and tear up my own hand, but I would have to do this slowly, without making a sound to boot. This was possibly the hardest and most coordinated maneuver I've ever had to pull off in my short life to date. But I ripped the screw through the last piece of skin and pulled it behind the corner, off the offshoot, just as I saw that terrible plastic Aladdin mask turn towards the vent. I didn't know it yet, but this would work to my advantage in two ways. But for now, the only one received was the extra adrenaline awarded by sight of such a terrifying image, helping me to focus more acutely in the dark and easier to navigate the maze of impalement around me. I never heard the vent being removed from behind me, but I acted as if I did, making my way towards another vent grate, this one lit with a brilliant red light. I dreaded what awaited me, but I also knew that hiding where I was would not be effective. They had to know I was in here. There was no other place I could have gone, and surely they would have found the fastening screws I had left when I first removed the grating. I listened at the vent before me, then peered through its cracks to see if the coast was clear. Aside from some queer and bewildering imagery, the scene was set for my escape from the spiky box of death through which I had inched my way through. I banged on the inside of that face as hard as I could, and on my third solid blow, I fell through into the room with a loud clatter. The first thing I noticed as I stood to my feet was my nearly naked form, now almost completely colored crimson. The amount of minor to moderate wounds left me drenched head to foot in my own blood. My hand was the worst, now oozing red fluids to the floor where I stood with a watery slap. Horrified at the image of myself, I scanned my surroundings. Large, red overhead lights sat in light fixtures set within the ceiling. The majority of the room was barren and concrete, the exception of large metal doors, not too unsimilar from those in the hallway I had just escaped from. The only difference being that these had a rectangular opening at about eye level on all of the three doors. The next thing I noticed was how incredibly hot it was in here. I felt like I was back in that infernal suit again. The smell that seemed to culminate here, spreading forth even into the vents I crawled through, was enough to gag and tear-jerk a hardened drill sergeant. It was sour and thick, nearly palpable on my tongue. I retched, but refused to vomit, and stifled the reaction back down into my gut. Long, black pipes, about 6 inches in diameter, wrapped around the entire room, even through the walls above those doors, in rows of four, and to add a touch of filth and grime, coinciding with the sickening aroma, the buzz of a million flies. I felt like I was crawling through the bottom of a dumpster on a hot Floridian August day, in nothing but my boxer shorts, and suddenly, the fear that I may catch something passed through me. But it was fleeting, for that fear was instantly replaced by something deeper and more demanding of my attention and deserving of my trepidation. I heard a whimpering, like a wheezing with cadence, as if someone was trying to say something but couldn't. I crept my way towards the door from which I had heard the muffled sound. As I got closer, it got louder, but the sounds were more like gibberish or obstructed in some way, and I still couldn't define them into something comprehensible. Nervous and curious, I stood on my tippy toes and elevated my line of vision until I was able to look through the rectangular slot in the door. That feeling. How do I describe that feeling? Despair, hopelessness, surreal, insane. I could use all of those, and any would apply. But they don't really capture the imagery and lasting feeling, emotional trauma, as it were, that it has surely left on me. At first, all I saw was a heap of flesh, metal, and synthetic fur that I did not understand. I don't even think I would have recognized it as anything at all unless I saw it moving. And moving it was. And I suppose it was this unreal image that sent my mind reeling into a place within the universe I never even knew I could have conceived of. And my mind kind of protected itself by shutting down completely as I slunk backwards slowly, still wrestling with the ideas and realities too large for my understanding to interpret. There was no way it spoke. There was no way. And this was the thought I kept repeating over and over, because it wasn't human. Not anymore. His, hers, I can't even tell you if this thing was male or female anymore. That's how horribly disfigured this thing was. There were large, metal braces jutting from the thing's face, its cheeks, I think, and both curved in towards the center and looked as though the nose had been stretched or surgically altered so as to connect to what looked like a rigid black suction cup, concave facing outwards. I can't tell if it was a bracket fastened to the substrate behind him or her, whatever, or if it wrapped the circumference of the throat, but the metal band appeared so tight that it looked as if it was cutting into the neck. Over what I expected to be its eyes were something similar to a pair of swimming goggles, but three or four times as deep, jutting far out from the face. When the thing's mouth opened and closed, I saw no teeth, no tongue, just dried blood and something like cotton balls. The rest of the body looked impaled through the torso at several points, but all cross braces connected to one of many outer circular rings that wrapped around the entire body, and infrequently connected with stitchwork between flesh and carpet-like black shag material. Arms and legs, I don't know, braces maybe? It was hard to tell, and I didn't look that long. If it did speak, it was saying, "Please, kill me." And now I was thinking it may have. I felt an instant pain on the back of my arm like a giant bee sting, and jumped and turned to find one of those thick, black pipes. They were burning hot and scalding to the touch, and revealed themselves to be the source of the immense heat in here. I felt for that thing in there. I really did. But I'm a coward. So I quickly made my way to the door I had taken note of earlier and gripped the handle. with a slow turn. The latch unhitched, and the door swung open, just a peek. The air that breathed forth at me was both stale and cooler than the room in which I stood. The space beyond was also dark, with only a few little LEDs shining like pinpoints in the blackness. "Hello?" I called out, trying to discern if the room was indeed occupied, but afraid that someone would hear me in the process, which is a little redundant, I know. I waited a few moments, assured myself that there was a handle on both sides, leaving me with the ability to travel back and forth as I pleased, before opening the door wider and stepping inside. I would have closed the door to the red-lit room behind me, but it was the primary source of light at the moment, and I would have been left in nearly pitch blackness had I shut out that light. Again, forms in the darkness, highlighted in places by the red incandescence that leaked in, gave me pause and left me more terrified than curious. I wish I could tell you that I stopped to investigate, but this was absolute insanity, and I'm not insane. The people strapped to those tables, all of which very much looking like people, unmodified, unable to move, unable to hear me, with headphones pumping God knows what into their minds, and those large goggles that I'm pretty sure were bolted to their heads, different from the others, wider and more holistically covering the face. And there were so many people. Male, female, old, young. I don't think I'll ever forgive myself for leaving those kids behind. Such little kids. But I'm a fucking coward, and all I managed to muster was enough courage to leave them all in that forsaken place, and went towards the door that I hoped would be my exit. I again cracked open the door, only the slightest, and peered out into what I assumed to be another room, but instead, I was greeted with a corridor running perpendicular to the aperture. I think I was holding my breath when I followed through with my decision to step into that hallway one more time. I didn't know, nor could I know, if I was in the same utilidor from which I had entered this forsaken hell. Everything looked the same, and now the dimsled utilidor stretched on endlessly in both directions. I heard loud music begin blaring out from the speakers set high up in the ceiling, and they were so loud and sudden, I jumped in place, ready to run back into that room with adults and children alike in despair. But after looking behind me and scanning before me, I saw no one. Nothing imminently threatening. So I decided to keep moving forward. Randomly choosing a direction, I chose left and started my walk of uncertainty towards a fate I could not anticipate. As I approached one of the doors to my right, a loud whirring of machinery and accompanying screaming that matched its decibel at first met the volume of the music and then began to overcome it. The closer I grew. I couldn't notice it at first because of the low lighting, but the reason I could hear the sound of agony and apathy in one continuous dreadful melody was because the door to that particular room was ajar, ever so slightly. I wanted to run past, curious or not. I didn't want to look in. I knew the depravity I may be in store for, but I couldn't risk moving past the door if there was someone in there to see me, looking in that particular direction. For the purpose of caution, I peeked a glance through the small sliver of space between the door and the jamb. There are some things the human mind should never have to take in, interpret, process, and subsequently store for future recall. It's a process that cannot be stopped, short of repressed memory syndrome, but I am unfortunately not that lucky, and am cursed to remember everything. The sight of whirring drills, twisted flesh, mutilation, sadism, and uncaring brutality. Where do I start? I think he was removing that woman's teeth, but what was he doing with that drill then? He was drilling into her face, but not her mouth. Her legs were bracketed into unnatural positions that must have left her begging for an anesthetic. But with those gloved hands in her mouth, there was no way she could beg for mercy, unless you could count gagging and muffled sobbing. And to make the scene all that much more dastardly and mentally intrusive, even though his back was to me, I could tell the large person in black, aside from a dangling off-white and stained apron, was wearing a plastic mad doctor mask, the character from the 1933 Mickey Mouse cartoon of the same name. What was he doing? It appeared as though he was doing whatever had been done to those poor things in those sauna boxes. More ashamed now than I was at the time, I left the poor woman to her doom, hoping to save myself from my own, and slunk past the door unnoticed. Maybe minutes. Maybe an hour. I don't know how long it passed. The melody Under the Sea, from the movie titled The Little Mermaid, blared repetitively over the PA system, complementing the repetition and scenery. Things had become a dull, droning terror that refused to relent, or so it seemed. I heard a loud noise to my left and jumped with a start, but whoever it was on me before I could get a look at them, grabbing me from behind. His arms were burly and enveloped in a jet black fabric. I was terrified and imbued with the strength of many men when I elbowed backward, planting my blow firmly between two ribs, causing him to suddenly release me. I turned and swung all at once with more power than I should have had, unaware that I was beyond my means and connected near the right side of the plastic Mickey Mouse mask, hitting the man in the temple. I couldn't believe it. I still really can't. I've never been the best fighter, and that's putting it mildly. But I had knocked the man clear, unconscious. I knew what to do in an instant, and drug the man off around the corner from which he came, through the door to my left, before even checking thoroughly where it had led me. I dropped the unconscious man where I stood and disrobed him, cladding myself in both his clothes and his mask. Honestly, behind that mask there was nothing astonishing, unless one would be expecting a monster. But I wasn't. Humans are the most cruel organisms on the planet, and this hellish nightmare could have only been created by nothing less than the most depraved of us. He was human, snoring like a baby, large and still intimidating, but only human. I had only noticed it once donned in my new outfit, but I wasn't really sure at first. Not until I had reached the end and spied the screws on the floor. But I was in the same hallway in which I had begun, having walked in through one of the various doors at intervals down the length of both sides, and the one to my left ended at the door. I had found my way back, but still had no plan of getting through. I examined it in the now brighter light, and without the imposition of the now missing Goofy costume, telling myself that there had to be a way. But it was just a smooth metal surface, set back into the wall so tightly that there was no hope of even getting a credit card into the seams. It was hopeless, and that's how I was beginning to feel. I pressed my body against the side, right back where I had started. someone would be coming soon. And then, I would suffer the same fate as those souls I left behind and forsook to their fate. A loud buzzing emanated only from the speaker directly above me, and the door pushed against me, mechanically and forcefully. I decided to press against the wall and hide behind it, praying to God I wouldn't be found out. My heart was beating so fast. I thought I'd suffer an infarction at any moment. As the door swung and concealed me behind it, screaming from the other side could be heard. A panicked screaming, coming from what sounded like a young man, begging for help, for freedom, and for his life. And the sounds of his cries were getting louder. Rushing by me, I saw two large men in plastic tune masks, dragging with them the source of the pleading. Once again, I thought only of my escape. And this was it. The door was open. Well, you're hearing this because I'm here to tell it. And I'm here to tell it because I escaped with my life. For a while, anyway. Those two monsters took that kid for reasons I don't think I'll ever understand. And I hope to never understand. To know them wholly is to go back there. To become a permanent resident of that place. What the fuck is Disney doing below the surface level of its parks? Those utilidors beneath every single resort. And resorts are now global. I left Florida, quitting Disney World without notice or even collecting my paycheck. I kept only in touch with my parents, who constantly told me to come home, to get help, that I was acting crazy and I could have suffered a nervous breakdown. But I know what I experienced. I can still feel the heat, smell the blood, and hear all those cries for my help. But a few days ago, I received word that my parents had gone missing. No sign of a struggle or forced entry, just vanished. But the thing is, as I sit here and finish recording this, my phone is ringing, and the caller ID says it's my parents. I'm gonna pick it up. Hello?
Well, all I can say is if you're still confused, the whole scope of things has been said between the lines in all stories connected to this one. A reperusal may be in order, and if you can stomach all that horror at once, my mask is off to you. For next weekend, I'll have more of that gore you crave. And until then, remember to like, share, subscribe, and turn on notifications so I can catch you all again next Saturday.